It is such a privilege to be here on a Good Friday because it is a really good day. So let's just settle our hearts and just think about the reflections that we're going to have this morning. As I was thinking about today, I live in a street where lots of people own boats. And as I'm driving up and down, I know that because we live in the Whitsunday, so many people love their boats. And it makes me think of Little Tom. Little Tom is just an ordinary kid, but a kid who loves boats. So much so that for his birthday, he was given a model kit. He spent time over his model sailboat. It had red sails. He knew every line. He knew all the rigging. He knew every nautical term. Starboard and port, bow and stern. Finally, Tom carried his new boat down to the beach. He carefully placed it in the water and slowly adjusted the remote controls. How smoothly his boat sailed. Tom sat on the beach for hours, sailing in the warm sunshine, admiring his little boat that he had built. He tested how far it could go out and how quickly it could sail in. And then, as he sailed out further, suddenly a jet ski zoomed past, caught the boat in the strong wash of water. Tom tried to direct it back to the shore, but the wind caught the sails and took it further out. And just then, the battery died on his controls. And he could do nothing except watch the red sails on his boat get smaller and smaller. Tom ran along the sandy foreshore as fast as he could, but his little boat soon slipped out of sight. Every afternoon that week, Tom searched for his boat. Finally, he had to acknowledge it was gone. A while later, Tom was walking past Cash Converters, the shop, and he spotted a model sailboat in the window. It had red sails. He was drawn to it like a magnet, and sure enough, it was his sailboat, the boat that he had built. He knew every line. Tom rushed inside. "That's my boat in your window," he declared. "I made it." "Sorry, son, but if you want that boat, you have to buy it." Tom counted out his savings and all his birthday money, exactly the price on the ticket. What a moment when he handed the money over the counter for his boat. As he left the store, Tom held his boat close and said, "Now you are twice mine. First I made you, and now I bought you." Good Friday is something that is a little reflective of Tom and his sailboat. We are God's own. We are twice his. Dearly loved, he made us and now he bought us. Twice his. Yeah. Over the previous weeks, we've been going on a journey. And we've considered some of the various covenants God made with individuals and the people of Israel. Every time God makes a covenant with people, there is a progressive revelation of who God is and the loving ways in which God desires to interact and fellowship with humanity. And today, we come to the culmination of all of these previous covenants, the most revered and holy revelation of who God is and how deeply he loves his people. So let's read how Jesus describes this as he celebrates Passover with his disciples. We'll read that from Luke 22, from verse 14. "When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table. And he said to them, 'I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took the bread and gave thanks and he broke it and he gave it to them saying, this is my body given to you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood which is poured out for you. But the hand of him who is going to betray me is with mine on the table. The Son of Man will go as it has been decreed, but woe to that man who betrays him. They began to question among themselves which one of them it might be who would do this. The Passover feast took the Jews back to the time of Moses, back to the time when they were slaves. It was a profound memorial of remembrance. This matzah bread that they shared at the Passover table was considered to be the bread of slaves. It was stodgy, filling, good for slaves when they didn't have a lot to eat. This bread reminded them of the years of oppression and slavery. And there were different schools of Jewish thought, whether the matzah bread represented the bread of oppression or the bread of redemption. It was to be cooked quickly, in less than 18 minutes, because that was the time that they designated that the dough would start to be affected by the elements and begin the process of fermentation. This matzah bread reminded them of the instructions God gave Moses on how to prepare their bread as they were rescued out of slavery. It reminded them that it was to be baked without leaven, without yeast or fermented dough. A reminder that God was bringing them into a new covenant, one that was cleansing their lives from the affliction that they knew. When matzah bread was cooked, it was coloured with stripes, representing the lash and the stripes they suffered as slaves. There were holes pierced within the bread, and their lives had been poked and prodded and pierced. It was acknowledgement of the pain of their slavery. Now, when Jesus, during this memorial, takes the bread and breaks it and says, this is my body given for you, do this in remembrance of me, he is taking all of the symbolism of all the previous covenants, all of the progressive revelation that God had been unveiling over the history recorded in Scripture, and he is saying, this is my body. In my body, I take the lash of slavery so you can be free. In my body, there will be pierces of oppression so you can live a full life. In my body, there will be no leaven. This is holy and pure, free from sin. Take this and remember that this is the new covenant, the covenant that supersedes all previous covenants. This is the new covenant sealed with my body, not the seal of the blood of sacrificial lambs, but my body that takes and seals this covenant in my own body. During the Passover memorial dinner, each adult who was partaking of the meal didn't just drink one glass of wine, but four cups of wine at specific and scriptured times during the ceremonial meal. Each cup represented the redemption of the Israelites from slavery under the Egyptians. The first cup was taken as they began their meal with a blessing. Take this and share it among you, Jesus said. The second cup was as they remembered and retold the story of their rescue out of slavery from Egypt. The third cup was poured and drank during the blessing at the end of the meal. The fourth cup was taken at the conclusion of the meal and at the conclusion of the evening as they recited the Hallel. The Hallel was a traditional prayer from the Psalms of thanksgiving and praise. But then there was a fifth cup. The fifth cup of wine was poured out, and it was left unconsumed. It was left and reserved for the prophet Elijah, the prophet Elijah. It was left for him in the hope that he would come and visit during the celebration. This fifth cup represented their anticipation that God would fulfill all of his promises of a future redemption. Luke mentions two glasses of wine, one at the beginning of the meal as he offers it to his disciples. And then Luke records that after the supper, Jesus takes the cup of wine. And I wonder if this refers to the fifth cup of the meal. I wonder if it refers to Jesus taking this cup. And he is saying, as he holds this cup, it is a symbol of future redemption, and he drinks from this cup. This cup was always held in reserve for the future of a coming saver, one like the prophet Elijah. If Jesus takes this cup and he passes it to his disciples and he declares, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you," no longer do we have to wait in anticipation. Redemption is no longer in the future. Sometime down the ages, the time is now. A new covenant is being sealed now. Another covenant is being cut between God and his people. It is a covenant of life. God is making a new covenant with his people. And that is more of this progressive revelation of who God is and the loving ways in which God desires to interact and fellowship with humanity. And each of these previous covenants was sealed with blood. This covenant, Jesus says, will not be sealed with the blood of an animal, but with my blood, my life. I will literally pour out my life to seal this covenant. It is that important. Take this cup. This cup representing the future redemption, and know that this represents my blood that now seals this new covenant. A covenant that is the culmination of all previous covenants, not covenants that were inadequate or flawed, but part of the progressive revelation of who God is and revealed ultimately and perfectly in the covenant sealed by the Son of God, Messiah, Jesus. God's commitment to Adam was that he would restore the world and humanity back to his beautiful, creative template for life and not death. Jesus stands and he crushes the serpent's heel. Death was ravaged this world that God had created as good. Now Jesus takes his life to defeat death. God's covenant with Noah showed how, out of disaster, an opportunity for a restored and better future was provided. And with the authority and responsibility for us to work on our own relationship with God and others, Jesus takes upon himself to restore a world that is broken and fractured and dead. to carry within himself the promise of a new life afresh. In God's covenant with Abraham, he's showing Abraham that he wants their relationship to be different from the gods around him, a God of love and connection, like father and son, like family. Jesus takes Isaac's place on the altar. God substituted a ram so that Abraham's only son could go free. Now Jesus takes the place of that sacrificial lamb to declare access to the deep worship of God, which need never be accessed by continually shedding the blood of another. One sacrifice for all time, for all people, that is sufficient. With the covenant with Moses, God redeems his people out of slavery so that they can be a people who are free, a treasured possession, and know a deeper level of relationship, like a groom loves his bride. Jesus takes upon himself to be the access into the holy of holies of the tabernacle, the way, the truth, and the life, into the holy presence of God. The Ark of the Covenant contained the elements of covenant, the people's commitment to those covenants, the tablet outlining the terms of their agreement, the bread of manna, the alive staff of Aaron budding out of something that had been dead, declaring that the priesthood would intercede for the people. Jesus takes it upon himself to be the bread of life, the manna, the staff of Aaron, taking dead and making it live again, interceding for life of the people. Jesus is showing God is faithful to the terms of their covenant, but he's also taking on the consequences or the curses of the broken covenant on behalf of the people because they were unable to keep the terms of the covenant, even a covenant that was sealed in blood. God's covenant with David showed that a king from David's family line would always reign on the throne, a rule of justice and mercy, perfectly balanced. Jesus takes his role as the appointed king who would fight for his people, not a physical war against the Romans, but a spiritual battle to intercede and fight for righteousness and life and dignity, as David did on Mount Moriah. Let's read how this symbolism of this eternal kingship was literally played out, even if it was unwittingly done so by the Romans. So let's read from Mark 15. Verse 16, the soldiers led Jesus away into the palace, that is the praetorium, and called together the whole company of soldiers. They put a purple robe on him and they twisted a crown of thorns and set it on him. And they began to call out to him, "Hail the King of the Jews." Again and again, they struck him on the head with a staff and they spit on him. Falling on their knees, they paid homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple robe and put his own clothes on him. And then they led him out to crucify him. Jesus literally and physically experienced the stripes and the piercing like the bread of oppression so that we can partake of the bread of life. "This is my body," Jesus said, "given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In my body, I will take the lash of slavery so you can be free. In my body, I will be pierced by oppression so you can live a full life. In my body, there will be no leaven. This is holy and pure and free from sin." The Romans mock Jesus and they take a crown of thorns and they beat him with rods over his head. And Jesus submits to this horrible humiliation, knowing that he really is the King of the Jews. He does wear a true crown that is honorable and true. He holds the victor's crown of life. And the Romans dressed him in purple, or Matthew's account says it was a scarlet robe. Either way, these are the colours of royalty. And they mock him with false homage. Their brutality cannot comprehend that Jesus is dressed in royal robes of righteousness, that in him, even through this horror, Jesus did not in any way putrefy his life with the leaven of sin, that he is the King of righteousness, perfectly clothed in purity and honour. Let's continue reading from verse 22. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And then they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him, dividing up his clothes. They cast lots to see what each would get. It was 9 in the morning when they crucified him. The written notice of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." They crucified 2 rebels with him, one on the right and one on his left. Those who passed hurled insults at him, shaking their heads, saying, "So, you were going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days. Come down from the cross and save yourself." In the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves, saying, "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. Let this Messiah, this King of Israel, come down from the cross that we may see and believe." Those crucified him with him also heaped insults on him. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And at 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing near heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling for Elijah." Someone ran and filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes down to take him down," he said. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain in the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus saw how he died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Over and over, we have seen that covenants were ratified in specific ways. There was the seal of blood placed over this covenant. The blood of Jesus is spilt, his life poured out, like the blood path that Abraham walked in covenant with God, like the blood of the Passover lamb that was painted over the lintels of the houses of the Jews in Egypt on the eve of their great rescue out of slavery in Egypt, the blood of the sacrificial lambs poured out by the priests in atonement ceremonies over the generations of worship, fulfilling the old covenant rituals. Jesus places his seal of blood over this new covenant. Each covenant we have seen was sealed not just with blood, but with fire. So where's the fire that seals this new covenant? It's coming. It's coming. It will be sealed on the day of Pentecost, a baptism of fire, the power of the Holy Spirit. This is described as a powerful, overwhelming experience like a baptism of fire. A new covenant sealed with fire, not the old consuming fire that burns and destroys, but a fire like Moses witnessed in the burning bush in the wilderness, a fire that does not burn up, but powerfully ushers in the presence of God. Each previous covenant was sealed as a representation of agreement. So it is important to know that God, the Holy Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit is in complete agreement as this covenant is sealed. Jesus publicly said that no one was taking control away from him. He was participating in this covenant making of his own accord. In John 10, it's recorded, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay my life down only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down on my own accord. I have the authority to lay it down and the authority to take it up again. This command I receive from my Father." In the gospel accounts, we witness the power of the Holy Spirit as we feel the physical evidence of the earthquakes and the supernatural darkness and the tearing of the veil in the temple, providing access to the Holy of Holies. But what of Father God, God the Father? We hear these words of despair that Jesus cried on the cross. Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" These words are as dark and as somber as the darkness that covered Mount Golgotha where Jesus died. And we are often led to believe that these words voice the abandonment Jesus felt from God the Father in that moment, that Jesus took upon himself the curses of every broken covenant. Christ redeemed us, it says in Galatians. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, "Cursed is everyone who is hung on a tree or a pole." Paul is quoting Deuteronomy 21, the law of Moses. It's defining the consequences of breaking the terms of covenant, the curses. Paul clearly tells us that Jesus is taking those consequences of our broken covenant on himself by becoming those curses for us. So alone in this place of despair, it sounds like Jesus, as he cries out these words, he is rejected by God, his Father. And he is turned, and God the Father turns his face away from Jesus because he was not in agreement of this covenant. That somehow God the Father, even though he is holy, that he is also mean and brutal, and his justice was not willing to be present as Jesus, his son, went through this horrific trial. And then we also feel grieved and abandoned and as lost as these words of Jesus sound. But to the Jews who witnessed these words, there was more to this picture than what we can initially see. Every Jew present had learnt the words of the Psalms from their mother's knees. To them, these were familiar words, words that they knew. They were the first lines to a song, and the lyrics were a song that resonated in their minds. It was a grand song of hope. And their brains would have heard those words and filled in the gaps and joined the dots and sang that song right to the end of the psalm. They didn't need to have this spelt out for them because this was a psalm that was so very familiar to them. They would have looked around and recognized much of what was happening right before their eyes. So turn with me to Psalm 22 and let's look at the lyrics of the song that resonated around the cross in the darkness that afternoon. Psalm 22, it's a psalm of David. And he says this, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from my cries of anguish? My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer. All those who mock me hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord, they say. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. Verse 14, I am poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart has turned to wax. It has melted within me. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death. They pierce my hands and my feet. My bones are on display. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment. Can you see how powerfully this scene is being played out before those who are witnessing what is happening? A song that was written 28 generations earlier by King David under the unction of the Holy Spirit. It describes insults and mocking, pierced hands and feet, thirst beyond imagining, people staring and gloating, soldiers dividing the spoils of a day's work as they cast lots for his clothes. And then from verse 19, there is a grand but. This but tells us that this is not the end of the song, it's not the end of the story, but there is a grand narrative that is being played out right to the end. Verse 19, But you, Lord, do not be far from me. You are my strength. I will declare your name to my people. In the assembly, I will praise you, for he has not despised or scorned the suffering of the afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to his cry for help. From you comes the theme of my praise in the great assembly. Before those who fear you, I will fulfill my vows. The poor will eat and be satisfied. Those who will seek the Lord will praise him. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. All the rich of the earth will feast and worship. All who go down to the dust will kneel before him, those who cannot keep themselves alive. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness, declaring to a people yet unborn, he has done it. Jesus declares his Father has not turned his face away. God the Father was in agreement. They were together in this painful experience as they planned from the beginning of creation that they determined this course. Verse 24, for he has not despised or scorned the suffering of his afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but he has listened to his cry for help. God the Father was on the cross with his son in that moment. He was suffering with him, knowing that this covenant was the plan from the beginning. They planned it together. They were executing its outworking together. He has done it. God has done it. God the Father has done it. God the Son is doing it. God the Spirit is present in it. Did you notice that David writes in his psalm a number of I wills? I will declare your name. I will praise you. That is future speak. Declarations of hope yet to be realized. And then as David finishes this psalm, he writes in the past tense. He has done it. Done, finished, completed. He has done it. Dominion belongs to the Lord, not the Romans, not the religious rulers. Jesus is making a very bold declaration that this death is not the end. That actually the despair is partnered with hope. Jesus spoke these things out as he hung there, barely able to draw a breath. And yet he still needed the people to know that God is love, God is faithful, God is restoring and repairing and reconciling us into the family of God. God is cutting a new covenant that is ultimate, the ultimate covenant of love. Jesus' death on the cross was not the last word of despair, but a demonstration of love and hope. Restoration was coming, like the lyrics of the song. It was spoken out as a seal of confirmation of God's new love covenant that is being cut with a blood path of mercy, a covenant of peace. Paul writes this about this symbol of this death on a cross. Paul says, "The message of the cross seems foolish to those who are lost and dying, but it is God's power to us who are being saved. The power of the cross is that it no longer represents the curse of a broken covenant. Now it is a symbol of God's power to restore and to heal and to redeem and to bless. Now it is a symbol that we are twice God's treasured possession, created and loved, now bought, redeemed, and secured. The power of the cross is that it is an enduring symbol of God's new covenant of love and mercy and grace. Every time we take the elements of communion, it is a memorial that reminds us of this song of hope that Jesus was declaring in that dark hour of the cross. It starts in despair, but it ends in the glorious hope that is bigger than the horror of that moment. God has not hidden his face. God is not indifferent to the suffering of his son or even the one who is inflicting the suffering. No, God is not indifferent to our suffering either and the things that we're going through. Rather, he comes and he stays with us in the mess and helps us through it. God does listen to us. He has dominion and authority and power. There is a new covenant being outworked this first Good Friday. God is the one in unity who is restoring this broken and fractured creation. He is the one who sets us in family. He is the one who is our priest, who loves us as a treasured possession. Jesus is the King of the Jews, just like the sign printed over his execution, stating that his insurrection was the crime against the Emperor of Rome, punishable by death. But Jesus turns that around and declares that actually the reality is that he is the King of all people who will reign forever from the house of David, fulfilling prophecy. All knees will bow to Messiah. Future generations will be told about him. Posterity will serve him. They will worship him and proclaim his righteousness over and over again. What an amazing thought for this Good Friday. That as we gather here today, we are part of the fulfillment of this prophetic psalm. We are part of those generations not yet born whom Jesus sang about. Our children are a fulfillment of this prophetic psalm that Jesus sang about. Not just the prophetic words penned by King David, but those prophetic words that were spoken out in the darkness by Jesus as he hung on the cross. It's sobering as we remember the significance of what happened that Good Friday. So let's reflect on some of these ideas around this new covenant that Jesus made with his followers that first Good Friday. What is my response to the idea of being twice God's? Created and redeemed by the immense price of love that kept Jesus on that tree for me. What is it like to acknowledge Good Friday is the culmination of every previous covenant, and Jesus took upon himself the consequences of those broken covenants. Is there hope in the idea that Jesus wasn't just yelling about being abandoned, but declaring a future of justice, of worship, and peace? How does this covenant made at Mount Golgotha help me articulate my own story of redemption? The classical master, Rembrandt, is famous for his etching of Jesus' crucifixion called the Three Crosses. One of these existing prints from his etching plate has been sold for £1.5 million British pounds. It is rightly renowned as a true masterpiece. This print is a powerful rendering of the last moments of Jesus on the cross. And as I explored some of the commentaries of the style of his work, there was a common theme of Rembrandt's ability to beautifully capture the human experience of people. He was always studying people, they said, their posture, their emotions, their victories, their failures and struggles. He was a master of representing everyday people, just like those he may have seen on the street around his hometown. And these are the type of ordinary people he depicts in this piece as they cluster around the cross. And it's quite clear each of them is present for many different reasons. Some are there for work, Roman soldiers on horses. Some are there to grieve, heartbroken by what they witness. Some are there to mock. Some of them look bored and are walking away. Some are there to be entertained. Some are there convicted of their own failure and sin that placed Jesus on the cross. There is even this idea presented by some that buried in the shadows of the crowd that Rembrandt, who is famous for his self-portraits, even etched himself into this picture, aware of his own failure and need for salvation. Whether that's the case actually or not, I like the idea that each one of us can place ourselves into the picture of the cross, that the covenant that is being outworked by Jesus is this personal. I even resonate with the idea that we all come to the cross for our very own personal reasons. And it is up to us to reflect on those motivations honestly and with conviction as we reflect on the message of Good Friday. Let's pray. Father God, we are humbled so much by the power of the cross, the power of the symbolism as you went through that suffering, so determined to cut a new covenant for us, a covenant of mercy and of love and of redemption. Father, that there was no failure in that moment of vulnerability, but it was a powerful declaration of the restoration that you are working and outworking. We thank you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that this was a covenant cut in complete agreement, that this was the plan from the beginning of time, right from creation. And progressively, you have been unveiling and revealing more of yourself to your people. We thank you and we love you. And we declare, Father God, that we want to be people of new covenant. We want to stand with you and outwork your plans in the way that we do life with you. In Jesus' name, amen.